hand. Can we just invite him into this place? Amen. Invite him into our midst today. See if he can bless us with his presence again one more time. Lord, we love you. We're thankful this morning, God, for who you are. Lord, we're thankful that we know you today. Lord, we ask that you just entertain us today, God. Be God today. God, show us how powerful you are. Lord, invest in us today, God. Move upon your people today. Manifest your presence and your power in this place. God, we need you today. Lord, we need you in this house. Lord, there are lies and situations and circumstances, God, that we need you to move in today. Lord, entertain us. Move upon us today, God. Lord, we give you the praise and the honor. Come on, church, can we magnify him today? Can we lift him up in this house? Can we exalt him? Hallelujah, you can do better than that this morning. Come on, church, let's entertain him this morning. Let's send up those praises today in the name of Jesus. Let's worship him.
Who can separate us from the
Get ready. We're going to take up our tithing and offering. I'm so thankful, so grateful that His mercies and His grace are new every day for me. I don't know that I'd make it very far without those. If you will, let's declare this together. Upon the authority of your word, I have given, it shall be given to me. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I am a tither. I bring my tithes today into your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked. The curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there is not room to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts demolished, and royalties received. My whole family saved and walking with God. Perfect health and abundance to walk in divine favor and blessings. I'm blessed going in. I'm blessed going out. And all that I do will prosper in Jesus' name. Amen.
To a secret.
Church, can you lift your voices this morning? Can you clap your hands, all ye people? Can somebody magnify the Lord with me this morning? Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. We thank you, Jesus. I have such a heavy burden in my heart this morning. As they begin to sing that song, God began to deal with me. I don't know if there's somebody here, if somebody watching, but he's not done with you yet. You made many mistakes in your past, made me make mistakes here recently. But he who begun a good work in you, he's going to complete it. He's the author and the finisher of your faith. And I know your circumstances may look dark. You may be facing some trials and things in your life right now that you feel like you fall away from God. But he's not done with you yet. And I'm so thankful that no matter what I do in my life, that I may fall. But when I rise, God will be there with me. So don't give up, whoever you are. Don't give up. God is not done with you yet. Come on, church. Can we take a minute? Can we just pray? Can we ask God right now to tug on the heart of those that are here this morning? Can you lift your hands right now and just begin to speak in the Holy Ghost? I feel an unction right now in the Holy Ghost that we can just pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, whatever the need is today, God, whatever the heart is in this place this morning, God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you begin to tug on that heart, God. Lord, that you begin to open their eyes this morning, God. Whoever's out here in this city right now, God, that wants to commit suicide this morning, God. In the name of Jesus, God, begin to tug at their heart, God. Let them know you're not done with them yet this morning, God. Lord, lift them up. I pray that you encourage them right now, God. Come on, church, can you clap your hands that God is doing it right now in the name of Jesus. He is worthy. I know what it's like to feel like you just want to give up. Sometimes it's easier to feel like that, to just walk away and just give up. But church, I'm telling you, it's not. Stand fast with all that you have within your mind and your spirit to stand fast. This is not the time or the hour to give up. This is not the time and the hour to walk away from the church or walk away from God. It's to get our eyes on him, church. We are in a spiritual battle. And I'm telling you right now, it's all about the church. God, stay in the church, young people. Stay in the church, young people. In the name of Jesus. We want to go, Lord, in prayer this morning for Sister Whitley, Eddie Fair, Marilyn Jansen, Gwen Mill, Sister Kent today, Tim Davison. Sister Hudson lost her brother. We want to pray for comfort upon that family today. I know grieving's hard, but I know a comforter, and his name is Jesus Christ. We're going to pray for Elaine's family today as well. Natalie Ramey, Sister Austin, that's Sister Kathy's sister. We're going to pray for Bella Lunt, need of a heart transplant. Evon Sisk, Isaac Andrews, his deployment, Ukraine. Our missionaries, Israel, our city, our prodigals, our lost loved ones today. If you have a need this morning, can you raise your hand and signify to God that you have a need? The Lord is here this morning, and I believe he is willing and he is able, and he is going to help those that are in need this morning, church. Can we go ahead and can we lift our voices today? And can we pray in agreement where one or two are touching on one thing? There we are. He's in the midst of us right now. Lord Jesus, we thank you, and I celebrate in advance for all the needs that are about to be spoken today, God, that you're going to be glorified in them today, God. I pray for healing upon those that are sick today, God. I pray for comfort upon those that are hurting today, God. Lord, I pray you continue to tug at the hearts of those that are lost today, our families today, God. Lord, I pray for a boldness to come on our young people this morning, God. Lord, I pray for a spirit of conviction upon this church this morning, God. Help us to encourage one another, God. Help us to link together one another, God. I pray for your anointing to be upon our minds and our hearts this morning, God, and upon our pastor today, God. Lord, we need a mighty move of your manifestation of your power today, God. Let it be known today, God, that this church serves the living God, the one true God, and his name is Jesus, God. Let your power right now, God, fall in the name of Jesus. Come on, church, can you shout that name of Jesus right now? Let's worship together in the name of Jesus.
His promise, an anchor to hold. And here in the midst of your sorrow, His presence is healing your soul. So just look up.
There's revival, it's stirring, shaking this place.
chains are breaking.
Him to fill the room here today. Come on, let's love him some more. Can we thank him? Lift your voices, your hearts unto him today. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. There's none like you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Magnify your name, Lord. We magnify your name. Hallelujah. Come on, let's magnify the name of the Lord. He is good. Hallelujah.
Every life can be restored when you feel.
Jesus, there is no empty space, amen, when he fills the room. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we magnify you, Lord. We're grateful. Thank you, Jesus. God, you're so kind. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. God, we magnify your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Mighty God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You are good, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, God. This morning, as Brother, we were in service, was the worship was going on, Brother Bruce leaned over to me and said he felt such a spirit of heaviness, and I think we all can feel that. Now, sometimes the enemy, he brings it, and that's a time when we can certainly take authority over that, because the enemy's defeated, correct? Amen. But I really felt and told Brother Bruce at that time, I said, I think sometimes we bring it with us. Amen. And it's not to throw all of us under the bus, by no means, but I think sometimes we're not nearly as prepared for what's supposed to happen in this place as what we should be. And again, we're not the one that bring it, it's him. But we're vessels that if we're not prepared, if we're not in the right mindset, and every one of us can have our minds in a thousand different places. And I know we've all been there. But I do believe sometimes we, you know, whether it be a spirit of heaviness or not, we certainly bring stuff with us that we ought to leave at the door. The Bible says to enter into his courts with praise, his gates with thanksgiving. There's something about when you come into thanksgiving with God, when it's from the heart, it kind of clears the way. Amen. Because when you put your attention on him and realize, God, you have been so good to me, whatever thing that might be heavy on our minds, and again, I'm not trying to belittle those things, but in light of his goodness, they're nothing. Amen? Praise God. That's why when you can magnify the Lord, amen, it makes everything in comparison so small. Amen. And when he is magnified, the Bible says when he is exalted, amen, he will draw all men to him. It prepares the way. Amen. I'm grateful for the goodness of God. I'm grateful for what the Lord has done and doing. And amen. And certainly, I know life is life. Praise God. But none of it ever changes or makes God any smaller. Amen. He is as powerful as he has ever been. Praise God. Amen. I get up here and then my iPad won't turn on. So I'm going to take that as if the enemy's trying to keep happening from happening what needs to happen. So we're going to keep pushing. Amen. You want to push with me? Let's push together. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 4. I want to direct your attention this morning. Anybody here ever have a battle that you really should have won, but you ended up getting beat? Amen. In all reality, David should not have won that battle against Goliath. He really shouldn't have. When you compare how the difference in their sizes, in the amount of the experience, but the difference maker obviously was David said, I don't come to you with a spear and a shield and a sword, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. The Lord made the difference when it came to that battle. But amen, there are many times we face things that, or we go through things, and in reality we ought to be on the, come out on the winning side, but whatever the reason is, sometimes we don't. Well, 1 Samuel chapter 4 is a kind of an indication of that. The children of Israel were going to go to battle. The Bible tells us the word of Samuel came to all Israel. Now Israel went out to battle against the Philistines. The Philistines, again, Goliath was a Philistine. Amen. These were not God's people. These were not people that had the favor of God on their lives. And so the Philistines, they encamped besides Ebenezer, and the Philistines encamped in Aphek. And the Philistines put themselves in battle array. They got themselves in position to go to battle against Israel. And when they joined battle, Israel was defeated. Everybody say, that's not the way it's supposed to be. But Israel was defeated by the Philistines. The Philistines, who were not God's people. They did not have God's favor. They did not have God's strengthening. Amen. But they were defeated by the Philistines, who killed about 4,000 men of the army in the field. And when the people had come into camp, after the battle had taken place, they come back. The elders of Israel said, why has the Lord defeated us today? Amen. So they say, let us bring the ark of the covenant of the Lord. Now the ark of the covenant, that was the mercy seat. That was where the two cherubims faced each other. That's where God said, I'm going to commune with you. That's where his presence emanated from. It was a very, very important piece of furniture in the tabernacle. And they said, well, let us bring the ark of the covenant of the Lord from Shiloh to us, that when it comes among us, it may save us from the hands of our enemies. Every time I read that verse, I just don't like the way it's worded. I don't ever want to refer to God as it. When it comes, it's going to take care of everything. Amen. You can't have relationship with something you call an it. Amen. But they weren't necessarily calling God an it. They were calling the ark, which was a representation. It was a very powerful piece of furniture. And they thought, if we can just get the box, it, into our midst, then we're going to be okay. Well, that's not the way it happened. The Bible tells us in verse 10, so the Philistines fought, and Israel again was defeated. Every man fled to his tent. There was a very great slaughter, and there fell Israel 30,000 foot soldiers. This was not a good day for Israel. Amen. 34,000 soldiers were killed. They were killed by an enemy that they should not have been killed by in all reality. Amen. Israel were the people of God. They had the the favor of God really was supposed to be on them. But so my question to you and I today is this: what's the matter? Amen. You ever have that question asked to you? Have you ever asked somebody that question? What's the matter? Amen. Why what's going on? Amen. And so again, we can look at this from different angles, but amen, we're going to attempt here this morning. We're going to get to the root of the matter today. Because this is my belief. You should never enter a battle wondering which side, whether you're going to be victorious or whether you're going to be a loser. You ought to not ever have to question that. Because the outcome of the battle does not depend on me. The outcome of the battle is Him, right? And there is nothing greater than God. There ought to be nothing I face in my life that I don't know without a doubt in my mind. God, you've got this. Everything's going to be all right. Amen. We ought to not tippy-toe and wonder, oh, I wonder if today is going to be a good day. You know what? Every day ought to be a good day. Boy, I wonder if this job's going to work out right. You ought to enter every experience, every situation with a very upbeat, positive attitude. And I'm not talking about just the power of positive thinking. I'm talking about having a confidence in a God that can do anything, and that a God who loves you, and that you have His favor. Amen. You ought to not question whether or not, amen, you're going to make it. I've had people this week, again, not associated with the church, but that have reached out to me, and they were saying, I hope I make it. We ought to have more, amen, within us understanding of who He is, rather than saying, well, I can't wait to make it. Amen. I can't wait to get there, because I've got confidence in the goodness of God. Amen. Lord, we love you today. We're grateful. We're thankful for your Spirit. We're thankful, Lord, today of your God, your presence we have felt in your word. We ask, Lord, as you will touch every heart, every mind. God, speak into our lives here today. We thank you in Jesus' name. Everybody said in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated for a moment. Praise God. Amen. You and I this morning, it goes without really question, we live in a world that is full of trouble. Everybody say trouble. Everywhere you look, trouble, problems, all of which are in abundance. Amen. These are issues happening, or there are issues happening today, amen, that many of us probably could not have even imagined happening 20 years ago. Amen. It's like new evils are being invented every day. Amen. In Paul's letter to Timothy, he declared that in the last days, perilous times would come. Everybody say perilous. Amen. 2 Timothy 3:1. That word perilous, it means troublous. It means harsh, difficult. And I really like the last one, hard to deal with. Anybody have any days in your life here lately? They've just been hard to deal with. Amen. Being fierce. Well, Paul said that those are the kind of days that were coming in the last days. Amen. I read this week the state of Missouri has the fourth highest rate in the country of residents that are prescribed antidepressants. Amen. Now, this morning, if you are one of them that have a prescription for that, please know that I am in no way criticizing the fact of that. But rather, what I'm wanting to bring out is that there are many people today that are looking and doing what they can in order to be able to cope in this very difficult hour. We live in a tough hour. We do. And again, I'm not here to tell you don't need to have prescription for Xanax or whatever the drugs are. That's not what I'm preaching here today, okay? Please don't take that from this. What I am saying is the reason I believe that there is such an uptick in the prescriptions of these antidepressants is that people are searching for something to help them cope, because we are living in a very, amen, hard to deal with kind of hour. We are. Amen. Now, There may be elders here today that can go back further than I can even go back, and they may say, well, life was hard then too. And I'm not discrediting that either. But I do understand and realize that we are living in a very tough hour. Amen. People are searching. They're trying to find ways to get through the day, to handle the many, many struggles that life produces. I remember when I was a kid, and again, I was a very sheltered child. My grandpa smoked cigarettes. So I saw him smoke. I was never around anybody that drank alcohol. And so my first exposure to alcohol was in Pizza Hut. When we're sitting at Pizza Hut and our neighboring table ordered a pitcher of beer, I thought, oh my goodness, I was scared for their lives. And I'm thinking, do they know what they ordered? I mean, I was like nervous about it. Never been around it, okay? I was very, very sheltered. Some of you may think, well, that was just a very normal thing. Well, you know, it wasn't for me. And it wasn't that my parents, you know, ridiculed people that drank. We just never, it was just nothing we ever had. I remember, and I will confess this, I found an open beer can one day. All right? I was out in some, I was probably where I shouldn't have been. We had a ball field and they had these trails. Well, I found an open beer can. And I don't know why I did it. I don't know, but I picked it up, looked at it, smelt it, like, ooh, all right, took a drink. It might have been that it had been sitting out there a long time, I don't know, but it tasted horrible, all right? So I don't understand why people drank in the first place. I was just never around it. And so as I've gotten older, obviously, I'm not here to criticize people that drink, because I have learned this. They're not drinking it because it tastes good. That's just my opinion, all right? Now, but they're looking for something to help them cope. Amen. Anybody here afraid of needles? Okay. Well, there are people that take needles and they inject themselves with these needles. Amen. And again, I've never been around that. I don't know what that looks like. I don't know what that smells like. But again, the reason that people go to those kind of lengths is they're searching for something that will help them cope. Now, I know that's not the answer. And I know that does not give them it's not like they take one drink and they're good for life, but they take another drink and they look for another drink and they find another high, because it's never enough. It never fixes the problem, but they're searching for something to help them cope in a difficult time of living. Amen. Each of us, we have in us, it's called a fight or flight response. And it's a response that we have to a threat, or now they're even saying it's to having stress. It's an automatic physiological reaction that activates what's called the sympathetic nervous system. It triggers an acute stress response that prepares the body to either fight or flight. Amen. Either I'm going to stand or I'm going to run. Now, the problem today is that this is not only activated when there's an immediate threat, amen, that's encountered, but it's the continued compilation of stress that keeps this response engaged. And it should not be on a continual basis, but it is. And it's caused, I'm telling you, it just, your body's not designed to live in that kind of state on a continual basis. Amen. And I cannot help but to think one of the reasons for that is we're living in perilous times. Scripture says that instead of things getting better, man, Brother Wells, you're just speaking all kinds of positive things today. Amen. Paul goes on, he says, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. The word wax there is not what you put on your car, all right? Amen. Or what you put on the floor. Amen. But wax means to progress, to increase, to enlarge a quantity, becoming more and more. But also here, it means to cut forward a way. In other words, amen, they're going to create new inroads of depravity. Amen. We are seeing that happen in our days today. New evils that we never could have imagined all of a sudden are coming about because of what Scripture says, that these evil men and seducers, amen, they're progressing, they're increasing, they're enlarging in quantity, and they're creating these new inroads of evil. One may wonder, how can the church be effective in days as perilous as what they are? Logic would tell you that things are just, they're just too dark, amen, for us to ever make a real difference. But rather, amen, in all of actuality, the church is actually designed to succeed in the darkest of times. Amen. It is the DNA of the church, amen, to not just exist or to survive, but it is the very design of the church to thrive in the most perilous and darkest and most difficultest of days. The church, amen, the church ain't waning. The church ain't staggering, but the church is standing strong. Amen. The church is still alive. It's effective, and the light of the church is shining as bright as it's ever shined before. When everything around us is drowning in darkness, the church will stand triumphant. Jesus told Peter, amen, that I'm going to build upon this rock my church, and the very gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Amen. I'm telling you, friend, we're a part of that church here today, and it's just as powerful as it's ever been. So our purpose is not to go and try to find a better structure. We need something to improve, amen, the structure we have. Oh no, we don't have to find anything better. I promise you, this thing was built to last. This thing that you and I are a part of, not only was it designed that way, but it was also guaranteed that, I'm telling you, you stay in the church, you're gonna be all right. Yeah, I know it's tough, and I know the days are dark, but I promise you, amen, God has made a promise in this church, amen, that not just we say, well, great things are gonna happen. I promise you, amen, great things are happening because, not because of me or any one person, but because we're a part of what God has already designed, and he made it and built it to last. Yeah. Ephesians chapter 2 says, now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and the members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. We are a part of something that's going to last. Now, I don't know if you're a Ford guy, or if you're a Chevy guy, or if you're a Mopar guy. Now, chances are, whichever one of those you align yourself with, you're pretty passionate about it. Amen. I've heard people that are not Ford problems, they say, well, Ford circles the problem. And you look at a Ford, it's a circle. And again, I really don't know where. I've got a GM product now, but I'm not really, I don't know what. I just like when they start. But if you're truly aligned with a certain, you know the ins and the outs of, you know what engines go where, and I ain't got a clue about none of that stuff. I don't know what an inline six, is an inline six an engine? Okay, I have no idea what that looks like. I don't know what a four barrel is. I'm like, where do you put the barrels at? I don't know what that means. Amen. I have a somewhat idea what front wheel drive means. I don't know how it works, but I know that the front wheels pull. I don't understand where the, I know somewhere in that body of a vehicle is called a drive shaft. I don't know where it's at. I'm not exactly sure what it does, but I think it has something to do with driving. I have no knowledge when it comes to vehicles. I can change oil sometimes. I can't anymore. I don't have the tools in it. But nevertheless, I'm not competent when it comes to cars. When it comes to building buildings, I don't have a whole lot of understanding about that either. I don't know what pitch of a roof this is. All I know is it's already too high for me to find out. I don't understand where you know what kind of centers that these joists are on. I have no idea what's the requirement. Do they need to be on a certain center? I don't know. I don't know anything about it. You don't want me coming building you a house. You don't want me coming making you or fixing working on your car. There's so much I don't understand. There are people today, these our students here, they have all these gaming systems. I don't understand gaming systems. If you wanted me to come over and play a game with you, I would be more of a hindrance than a help. I don't know what I'm doing. I wanted to connect to my boy when he was young because he loved playing games, and so I was gonna play with him. I bought another controller. And he's like, Dad, do you have to play? Because I was more of a hindrance. He's like, Dad, you know, you don't have to. You can do something else. I'm okay. So I just don't. It don't my brain. There's a lot of things I just don't know how to do. I don't know what I'm doing. I was talking to a friend of mine a few weeks ago. Actually, he was talking about hunting, and man, he was so impassioned about this going turkey hunting, and he was naming off the kind of decoys he needed. He named the kind of gun that he had. He had like the almost like the serial number. He knew everything about it. And he's like, do you ever hunt? I'm like, well, I have. What kind of gun do you shoot? I don't know. I think it's a 12 gauge. I have no idea what brand it is. Don't ask me about the shells. They're red. I don't understand all that stuff. Amen. Anybody fit in this category with me? Amen. Where you got you're like surrounded by people who are experts and stuff, and you're like sitting here thinking, I don't know anything they're talking about. That could be us as a church if we're not careful, because we live in such a time that there's challenging times. And you would think, well, what we need here, we need an expert. We need somebody that really knows what they're doing. And then God calls me to be a pastor. I'm like, God, what are you doing? I don't know anything about anything. I struggle in some of the most basic concepts. But I realize more and more that it's not based on my proficiency, right? Because if I'm not careful, I can quickly, amen, go to this idea that, uh-oh, we're all in trouble because I don't know what I'm doing. Amen. Sister Dorothy, you talked about trust today, right? Well, let me tell you, when we start feeling inadequate, that's a trust issue. Because we don't necessarily trust ourselves, but we have a hard time trusting the one that put us in the place that we are, and we're looking at the world around us, and we're seeing it's getting darker, they're waxing worse and worse, and God, what have you done to me? The darkness of this world is no match for the church today. What I've got to get to the understanding of, this is not my church. This is not your church. This is His church. Amen. This church was designed way before 1947, when this particular body, amen, was first brought together. But this has been a church for a long time. And the maker and the founder of this church, he knew exactly what he was doing. And he knows exactly what he's doing when he calls someone like me that don't know anything about what he's doing. But because it's not on me, it's all on Him, and He's the one that's going to make us victorious. Amen. John 1:5 says the light The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Amen. The light shines in darkness. The darkness can never be too dark. Amen. And blot out the light. Anytime there's light, it will always displace the darkness. Amen. Isaiah said, no weapon formed against us will prosper. How many believe that today? Yeah. Amen. Praise God. My wife and I, a couple of weeks ago, man, we kind of got into it. And it was all about snakes. She wants to defend snakes. She has issues. I don't care how good that snake is. I don't care how many bad snakes a good snake eats. There's no such thing as a good snake. Snakes are evil. For whatever reason, God allowed that snake to allow the devil to embody that. A snake. A snake is cold-blooded. Everybody say cold-blooded. Amen. Because of that, though, it is limited in its ability to endure. Cold-blooded animals gotta have some source of heat. They can't endure. They can't always keep going. In the scriptures, again, the serpent is a symbol of evil, and I believe that. They provide a representation of evil. There's nothing, and I'm going to get off my snake soapbox, but there's nothing good about them. Amen. They often move by twisting. They should not be able to do that. Amen. Praise God. And so the nature of evil is to do what? It's to twist. A lie is the twisting of a truth. Amen. The impure is the twisting of what is pure. Evil itself is the twisting of what is good. Serpent, snake, ugly, evil. Evil is cold-blooded. Amen. What that means is this. Though evil may have its day, it may be perilous days today. Yes, the evil men may get worse, wax worse and worse. Amen. Praise God. And it may, even evil may even have its victories. Amen. It's time to move and it's time to strike and cause havoc. But yet, evil remains cold-blooded. Therefore, it can never endure. It is limited in its time, no matter how powerful the evil may appear. Amen. No matter how triumphant and unstoppable that it may seem to be, it cannot, it will not last. The power of evil is only really for the short term, the momentary. Amen. Its days are always numbered. And in the long run, evil always fails. So don't for a moment in the darkest of days get to thinking in your mind that you're on the wrong team or you're fighting against the wrong enemy, because I'm telling you, if you're in the church today, you're on the right side. It may look dark and the odds may be stacked against us, but that which is evil out there cannot last. It is not able to endure. In our reading today, amen, Israel lost. 4,000 men were killed. They came back to camp and they said, why has the Lord defeated us today? What's the matter? Amen. I just want to real quickly clarify, God was not against them in any way. He was not the issue, nor was he the problem. So when we come to church and we, Brother Bruce, when we feel that heaviness at times, and we do, we're ebb and flow, you know, that's part of being human. But we got to be real careful when we start identifying those kind of things, because we can start thinking that, well, what we might need is better singers or better preacher or better musicians or a better church building. Let me tell you, there's nothing wrong with the church. Amen. Praise God. The church is not the issue. I just wish the people were more friendly. Well, we probably could be more friendly, but that's not the problem. Well, you know, if we had someone that really knew, understood all these, yeah, that would be helpful, but that's really not the problem. Amen. The reality in our text is that they, the ones that were saying, why did the Lord defeat us? What's wrong? They were blind to the real issue of that disaster. They did not discern their own corruption. It wasn't God. It wasn't that God had a bad day. It was them. Proverbs 14 and 12 says, there is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Oh, it's amazing how we can justify our actions and our ways, but the Bible tells us that those ways are going to end us in destruction. I'm telling you, you don't want to go that way. Amen. Samuel later, he spoke to him in chapter 7. He said to all the house of Israel, saying, if you return to the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the foreign gods and the Ashtoreth from among you, and prepare your hearts for the Lord. Serve him only, and he will deliver you from the hand of the Philistines. See, they had these graven images hanging on their walls. They had these idols that they were worshiping in their midst. And so when they got defeated by the Philistines, they said, oh, wait a second. Let's go get the ark. Let's go get the box. It will surely save us. Let me tell you, friend, my relationship is not with an it. Amen. An it would be the house of God is an it. It's not alive. It's not a breathing thing. That's why I can't just have a relationship with the house of God. Amen. Thank God for the house of God, right? But I've got to have something more than just a location. I've got to have something more than just a ritual. I've got to have a relationship with something that's alive. Amen. It's got to be more than just that box. Amen. Isaiah 44 addresses idols. He says, those who make an image of all of them are useless. They're precious, and their precious things are of no profit. They are their own witnesses. They neither see nor know that they are, may be ashamed. Who would form a god or mold an image that profits him nothing? Amen. Why would someone do that? Verse 17, the rest of it makes into a god his carved image. He falls down before it. He worships it, prays to it, and he says, deliver me, for you are my God. But they don't understand, for he has shut their eyes, and they cannot see their hearts, so they cannot understand. And no one considers in his heart, nor is there knowledge nor understanding to say, I have burned half of it in the fire. Yes, I have also baked bread on its coals. I have roasted meat and eaten it. And shall I make the rest of it an abomination? Shall I fall down between or before a block of wood? He feeds on ashes, and deceived heart has turned him aside, and he cannot deliver his soul, nor say, is there not a lie in my right hand? Why would someone trust in a handmade god, amen, that possesses no power? Can I tell you, and again, this is my own opinion, amen, perhaps it's because, amen, that thing that is man-made, it's something that can be tangible, it's something they can hold on to, it's something they can set on a shelf, it's something they can wear around their neck, it's just something that it represents, but they really look at it as being their God, amen. Perhaps it is because it's tangible, but what good is tangible if it's powerless? Because the God I serve, I can't always see. The God in which I give my trust to, I don't always feel him. I'm not always aware of his location. Sometimes it feels as if he's far from me. But oh, I'm thankful to know a great God that I have. Amen. The Bible tells us in this late hour, amen, that he himself gave some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, right? For the purpose of what? For the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. See, Jesus, when he told Peter, upon this rock I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it, he also had a structure and a plan for that church. And it would be what we know as the fivefold ministry. Amen. It would be ordained and for the purpose of equipping edifying, amen, the saints for the work of ministry. The word equipping, it means complete furnishing. It means a preparation or a training that fully qualifies realize none of us here today was on this earth when Jesus was walking on this earth. We don't know exactly what Jesus looks like, but yet, amen, we give our full, unadulterated trust to him. And the reason is because Jesus made a church 2,000 years ago. He founded it, and he provided a structure so that 2,000 years later, amen, we still have the remnant of what that church is about, and it's still in existence today, and it's still as effective today as it's ever been. You say, well, preacher, if that's the case, what's the matter? It ain't God. God's not weakened. God's not getting too old. Amen. God's not out of date. God's not irrelevant. I promise you, he is on point as he's ever been. So you think, well, we got to go do this and get that. Nope, we better be really careful, because we don't want to make the same mistake that they made there in 1 Samuel chapter 4. I don't ever want to try to replace God with an it. The only way that I'm going to be able to be, quote, successful, and I hesitate even using that word, but the reason I say that is success is doing the will of God. That's being successful. It's not about the number of people we have in a service. Thank God for everyone that is here. And yes, we want to strive to reach as many as we can. But it's not the number, the amount of people that determines our success. Because our success is determined by not trusting in any kind of idol. Amen. Not having anything else in my life, amen, that would take me away from a relationship that goes beyond a box and is an intimate relationship, amen, with my Savior. Amen. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, we're getting ready to land. A verse that we quote continually. Now to him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Who's that talking about? God, right? Now to him, he's able. Amen. If we could tonight or today put all of your troubles and somehow be able to display them in front of all of us, there is not one problem here this morning that he's not able to handle. He's able. Matter of fact, Paul says he's able, but to do exceeding, but not just exceeding, but abundant. I mean, it's like emphasis upon emphasis upon emphasis. This God can do anything you need him to do. And it'll be beyond anything I can see, anything I can ask. Amen. But then here's comma. According. What does that mean? That means you and I play a part. This gets kind of theological, thin ice, but God does anything he wants. I know that. He's omnipotent. But in Ephesians 3 and 20, God who is able, it says according to the power that works in us, that we possess. The Bible says we have a treasure in this earthen vessel. This power is not some far-reaching place from us. It's not like in a different location. It's within us. If those in 1 Samuel chapter 4, and I know it's a different dispensation, but they're thinking we got to go somewhere else and we got to go get our answer and bring it to us. But today, it resides within you. To them, God willed to make known, Colossians 1:27, what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Acts chapter 17, so that they should seek the Lord and hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live, move, have our being. Amen. We're there. He's here. I'm telling you, church, we're not looking for another Jesus. We're not looking for a modern church. This church that Jesus founded 2,000 years ago, it is just as powerful as it's ever been. So what's the matter? It's within. We enter into his courts with thanksgiving, or his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. Amen. I hope that we get more face-to-face Jesus time outside the walls of this building. I hope we're not just relying on coming to here on a Sunday and a Wednesday to get enough Jesus to last us the rest of the week. We better make sure we understand and we know him on an intimate level, on a daily basis, because this is not our it. Amen. The world we're trying to reach is outside these walls. Let's stand here today. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But then Paul writes an answer as to how do you handle that. He says, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. He didn't say when things get really, really bad, just throw your hands up and scream and quit. No. He said, you continue doing what you've been taught. You continue doing the very thing. We're not here to invent another doctrine. We're not here to, amen, to find a way of compromising. We are here today, amen, to stand on the shoulders of those that's gone on before us. Amen. To stand true to the structure that was designed in this book. And I promise you, church, that revival that we dream of having, it's happening. It's happening. So if you don't think it's happening, if you're wondering where have I been? Well, come on, do some searching right here. There might be some idols. I know we don't call them idols today, but there may be some things in your life that you've learned to live with and you've learned to justify. You might want to bring them down to the altar here today, and you might want to get rid of them and say, you know what, God, I don't want to share any of my space with anything other than you. I want you, because I do know this is a dark hour. I do know I can't do this on my own ability. And so, God, I don't want anything, amen, clogging the way, interrupting the connection. I want to go ahead and just get rid of that. That's called repentance, amen. I want to repent, amen. I want to be clean. I want to be what God has called me to be. Anybody else here today? Amen. Whatever needs you have, whatever situations that you're facing, I assure you this morning, amen, God is well able. But I also understand, amen, as Paul wrote, it is according to the power that works in you. And you may have some repenting, some cleansing that needs to happen so that his power, amen, can be at its most paramount state. Amen. I don't want anything to be interrupting the power of God in my life. I want to get rid of it. I want to live my life for you, God. Amen. I'm thankful to be a part of that church today. Come on, church. Amen. Let's reach out to him in the name of Jesus. God, you are good. You are faithful to me. Amen. Amen. You're big enough to handle my trouble. Come on, let's worship him. Let's thank him this morning.
Let him turn it in your favor. Watch him work it for you.